welcome to the first session of the, lecture series of the Sussex Centre for Folklore, Fairy Tales and Fantasy. It's great to see so many people here, some familiar faces, and also it's good to see so many new faces. One of the things that I think the Sussex Centre ought to be looking at, and I've been aware of this for some time, is fables. There are, in some ways they are, I think, slightly overlooked in relation to folklore, fairy tales and fantasy. But it seems to me, as John's talk I'm sure will show, that fables have a lot to do with folklore, that one of the most ancient forms of folklore. They have much to do with what came to be called fairy tales, and arguably they have quite a bit to do also with modern fantasy. So I think we ought to be looking at fables, and I can't think of anyone better to introduce fables to us than John Vernon Lord. John studied art back in the 1960s in the Central...
50s, I'm afraid.
Central School of Art.
And finished up at the Central.
Where he met many people, including Mervyn Peake, which I'll come back to. He then did a lot of freelance professional work. One of the things that deeply impresses me is that he actually designed the cover for the second Deep Purple LP. And then later on he moved into Brighton School of Art, which later became part of Brighton University, where John was professor of illustration and fine art for many years. He's made a great name for himself illustrating most famously Aesop's Fables, then the nonsense verse of Lear, the hunting of the snark. I met John for the first time earlier this year when he came to the Mervyn Peake conference and gave a fascinating paper on being taught by Mervyn Peake back in the early 1960s. Well, the first time I actually clapped eyes on John was in television, when he was interviewed on a programme called, was it The Beautiful Book? And it was to do with illustrating Alice's Adventures in Wonderland. And I really enjoyed that section of the programme in which John was talking about his project. I don't know if it's still ongoing, of illustrating Alice. So I know I should say that John has been suffering recently from a bad cold, so I'm delighted he's brave and colour. I did suggest that a whiskey or three is probably the answer, but he's been very abstemious, I guess. Slept a little MCIT, so if his voice starts to go, that's what's going on. So let us please give a very warm welcome to John Vernon Lord.
Thanks, Bill. Nice of you to all come. One always dreads these occasions, if only one or two turn up and we just sit in the corner of the room, but it's nice to see a lot of you here. Thanks for coming. Briefly, I'm going to be talking about the history of fables, how they arose. And I'm going to talk about illustrations of other people's work and of my own book. And when you see JVL in front of a caption, it means it's my picture in black and white. And off we go, I think. It's a prepared lecture. I've got such a lousy memory, and sometimes if I don't discipline myself by writing it out, I gabble on for about 2 days. And I'm sure you'll not want that, so we'll start. Get used to the technology. From the beginning, there's been a struggle between humans and animals. We fear them and admire them. We hunt and slaughter them, and we eat them. Sometimes they eat us. We put them in cages and display them in zoos. We keep them as pets, and we experiment on them in laboratories. The taxidermist stuffs animals to show them in museums, and a recent so-called artist has exhibited sliced up creatures floating in tanks of formaldehyde, suspended in death. This is called art. whereas a variety of sliced up sausage meat from Italy is called bologna. We have sacrificed animals to the gods, and we have in turn deified them. We go to great lengths to conserve them, but we also contribute towards their extinction. They, just like humans, are often bent on acquiring territory and status for themselves. Animals do not seem to worship gods, nor do they take much interest in progress. We have developed a habit of investing animals with human characteristics, a notion that our behaviour is mirrored by theirs. We have transformed animals into symbols, and we need animals to describe ourselves. Our language is full of allusions to animals, from metaphor and simile to idiom and cliche. We can wait till the cows come home, take the bull by the horns, tell a cock and bull story, or talk bullshit. We can move like a bull in a china shop, score a bullseye, and have a herd instinct. To call a woman a cow is like showing a red rag to a bull. Animal and symbol have thus become one, and in fables they tend to be the scapegoats for getting at the truth. Fables are about today as they were about yesterday. Since the earliest time, man has depicted animals on cave walls, and later artists and designers have represented fables in a manner of ways. There are fable versions on canvas, on panels, in marble bas-reliefs, as sculptural groups, as wood carvings, on tapestries and stuccoed ceilings, and fables appear on coins, medals, crockery, clocks, jigsaw puzzles, cigarette cards, and sewing samples, as well as on inkstands, chair covers, jewel boxes, thimbles, quill holders, washstands, and fountains. Monks have illuminated them on manuscripts, and they have continued to be a favourite subject for book illustrators. Here is an image demonstrating how Robert Henryson, the Scottish poet, symbolised the fable in his prologue to his 1566 poem. The story of the fable is the nutshell, and the kernel is the moral that you digest. A translation of that difficult, I'm sure Bill can read that very cleverly. And it goes like this: although the nut's shell is hard and tough, it holds the kernel and is delectable. So there lies a wise enough doctrine and a fruitful one underneath an imagined fable. Another metaphor for a fable was devised by La Fontaine in the 17th century. He said that a fable consisted of two parts, which might be termed body and soul, the story being the body and the moral the soul. Fables are something more than what they appear at first glance. They are essentially metaphors, and the concise and pithy nature of most of their tales charged them with a concentrated energy, which allows for repeated reading and closer inspection. Fables are fictions that reveal the truth. In them, we see life in the raw as we lift the skin from the story and come face to face with the bare bones of the truth. This hidden truth emerges as we grasp the metaphorical meaning that underlies the fable's narrative. Fables aim to tell the truth for what it is and leave readers to judge for themselves what can be learned from them. The history of the Aesopic fable is a complicated one. By the way, can you hear at the back?
Yes.
You're okay. Is a complicated one, and its origin is lost in the mists of time. It is possible that fables first arose among primitive societies, whose occupation brought them into a close contact with animals. Shepherds or hunters would have watched the behaviour of creatures and liken their actions to those of humans. Close-knit family communities would have found the fable an ideal agency for giving advice or reproof without causing too much direct offence. Similarly, in government or court circles of the past, when frank talking might have resulted in instant punishment, the use of fable was a safer or more palatable way of offering counsel or conveying an unpleasant truth. The The function of a court jester or fool was not only to entertain, but also he was permitted great liberties with the king, queen, and courtiers, in the way he was allowed to pass on home truths to them. In the classical tradition, the Greek slave Aesop is said to have invented the fable, and even if he did not, he certainly popularized it through his telling, and his name has become a convenient peg on which to hang anything of this form. There is nothing so difficult as the art of making advice agreeable, wrote Joseph Addison in The Spectator, who nicely summed up the advantages of fables like this. We are made to feel we are advising ourselves. We excuse the author for the sake of the story and consider the precepts rather as our own conclusions than his instructions. The moral insinuates itself imperceptibly. We are taught by surprise and become wiser and better unawares. Fables were long transmitted through oral tradition. They were then recorded from the spoken word into the written word. They were set in prose and versified. They were translated, paraphrased, enlarged, freely adapted, altered, and recast over the centuries. They migrated from one place to another, and they were assembled to form collections, and these in turn were gathered into anthologies, each overlapping intricately one with another. Important early collections are incomplete or have been lost in their original form, but then discovered through coincidences to be found in later transmitted, compilations. I nearly did that orange thing. When I was talking last year, instead of saying the origin of the species, I said the oranges of the species.
And you couldn't stop saying that.
And I couldn't stop saying it. There we go. Gone too early there. Fables appear on coins, metal. Oh, I've read that bit, haven't I? If I go spontaneously, see, I lose my track. Where are we? I think this is it. We know very little about Aesop, other than knowing that he was a teller of fables in the early 6th century BC. Herodotus tells us that he originally came from Thrace and later became a slave. On the Greek island of Samos. The fictional account of Aesop's life tells us that his first master was Xanthus, who sold him to Yadmon, who in turn eventually gave the slave Aesop his liberty as a reward for his learning and wit. Aesop then apparently visited the court of Croesus, who sent him as an ambassador around Greece and Asia Minor, where he is alleged to have narrated his fables. Legend suggests that Aesop met his death around 560 BC at the hands of the priests of Delphi, who are said to have hurled him over a precipice for driving them nuts with his provocative behaviour. They had set him on a trumped-up charge for stealing the golden cup from the temple of Apollo. But Aesop had the last word, for his death did not go unavenged, as he prophesied in his last fable. His prophecy was realized when a series of calamities, including famine and pestilence, was to strike the citizens of Delphi sometime afterwards. Drawing upon the early fictional accounts by one called Planudes, Roger Lestrange described Aesop as a man of a mean condition and in his person deformed to the highest degree, flat-nosed, hunchbacked, blobber-lipped, a long misshapen head, his body crooked all over, big belly, baker-legged, and his complexion so swarthy, he was in a manner tongue-tied too. Aesop is said to have invented the fable around the early 6th century BC, and as it happens, only a handful of fables can reliably be said to be by him. Early fables can be traced back to the 550 Yakata stories of the Buddha, the Indian epic entitled the Mahabharata, the fables of Bidpai or Pilpay and its Arabic equivalent in Kalila and Dimnar, and the Sanskrit literature of the Pankatantra, which we've got here, giving you an idea of what they look like. The foundation stock of Aesop's fable, as we know them today, was compiled in Athens by an antiquarian scholar called Demetrius of Phalerum. His 4th century BC manuscript of some 200 fables is now lost. We know it was to influence many subsequent fabulists. Another influential lost collection of 231 fables is that of the Augustana, a collection of Greek fables that was probably put together in the 2nd century AD. The Greek poet Phaedrus wrote about 150 Latin fables around AD 40, of which 94 have been preserved. Babrius wrote a collection of Greek fables about 100 or 200 years later. Both Phaedrus and Babrius followed the Demetrius collection, and the main source of Aesopic fables used by medieval writers in the Middle Ages in Europe was compiled by a Roman called Romulus before the 6th century AD. These are essentially Latin prose renderings of Phaedrus's verses. It was the Romulus collection that Steinhaus chose to begin his pioneering printed edition of fables, which Caxton was to follow through a French edition in his first printed English collection of 1484. Now, all this is a bit indigestible, and I'm merely skating over the whole history of fable. Perhaps I should just look at that. I mean, you can see here that this is the classic Greek Latin thing, Greek, and this is the Arabic Indian, and they coalesce in Babrius. Phaedrus is from the Latin store, and they come down until you see Caxton's Aesop, which is the main English fables that we experience. But that's from Joseph Jacob's book. Very useful. It's about the only decent, if you like, family tree of where fables come from. But you can see how complicated it is. There are many more fables in passing, and I just mention a few of them. There's Mary de France, John Lydgate, Robert Henderson, Alexander Neckham, John Ogilby, Jean de La Fontaine, Afra Ben, an interesting rhyming doggerel version, Roger Lestrange, which is this book here, 1692 edition. Very salty, interesting way they're expressed. And we have George Fowler Townsend, Joseph Jacobs, Thomas James, and hundreds of others. All these brought a great contribution to the fable tradition. I'm sorry if all those facts were rather indigestible. The first dated illustrated printed book was in fact a book of fables. Ulrich Boner's Der Edelstein in 1461, seen on the top left here, and below on the left we have Steinhauer's version of The Fox and the Grapes, and Caxton's on the right. We can see how they are both very similar. In fact, Caxton's woodcut was copied from a French edition of Aesop, which itself was copied from Steinhaus's Ulm edition printed by Zehner in 1476, which is most likely to be derived from an early illuminated manuscript. So in Caxton's image, we probably see a copy of a copy of a copy of a copy. That's the Caxton over here. I'm now going to talk today about my own thoughts about illustrating fables and how I approach the subject for my own book, which was published by Jonathan Cape in 1989. On the way, we'll be also looking at a few other illustrators of the past who mostly worked in black and white. It is because of their constant relevance and their pithy and concise nature that first attracted me to preparing a book about fables in the late 1980s. I'd always loved the illustrations of fables by so many illustrators of the past. The first thing I set about doing was, when embarking upon the book, was to plan which fables I wanted to include. This got me involved in reading and buying loads of books about the subject. Books by Ogilby, Roger Lestrange, Croxall, Jacobs, Edwin Perry. I mean, the Bible, if any of you are become really interested in fables, this is one of the best books to get. It has 725 of them in it. and it's a very scholarly edition, but it's also a very friendly edition. That's the book to get, which you can look at later if you are interested. And that's the green one in the middle there. I became addicted to fables and amassed a collection of more than 200 books. Eventually, I selected 300 fables in all and illustrated 110 of them. What I needed was an author to translate them, and I wanted a poet. I'd always admired James Mickey's translation of La Fontaine's Fables, initially published in 1979. James was a classic scholar who had also translated Horace, Marshall and Catullus, so I asked him. I showed him what I'd illustrated so far, and right away he said, "You're on." Ben Edwin Perry's corpus of 725 Greek and Latin fables in his book, Aesopica, was my Bible in making the selection. These are conveniently translated in his Badris and Phaedrus for the Loeb Classical Library, the little green book I showed you. I think I'm illustration too far. I passed my choice of fables to James for translation into his own poetry. He translated them at tremendous speed. They were told economically, wittily, and precisely to the point, employing an intriguing method of internal rhyme. While I was working on the book, we had an awful storm in 1987 which brought down a huge pine tree onto my studio, thus delaying progress on it. So I commemorated this grim event by having the illustration of the fable of the oak and the reeds here as endpapers. In this fable, we have the reeds bowing before the storm, reckoning that yielding to the wind can help their survival. It shows that obstinacy and willfulness, such as the oak's stubbornness, can lead to a downfall, whereas it can sometimes be prudent to give way to a superior power. It also suggests, perhaps, how the mighty fall. It took 900 hours during 4 years to complete all the illustrations for the book, and on top of this, I spent much of the time reading and choosing the fables, planning the sequence, designing and writing the introduction and the index. I was also a full-time university teacher. The fables are the inspiration for doing such illustrations. They give us powerful insights into human frailties, and they show life in the raw. I will show you just three early illustrators now, but we will come across others as I go on with the talk. Here's an open spread with illustrations based on Bernard Salomon in a tiny book I have printed in Paris in 1585. The fisherman on the left catches a small fish who begs his captor to release him back in the water, claiming that he's far too small for the dining table. The fisherman replies that there is no point in losing what he's already got in pursuit of something unpredictable that might come to nothing. A bird in the hand is worth two in the bush, as it were. The ass and the horse on the right is a fable about an ass which had been overburdened by his owner. When he passed by a horse, he asked if it would share some of his heavy load. The horse refused, and the ass dropped dead with fatigue. The owner of the ass thus placed the entire load, plus the body of the ass, on top of the horse, making the point that if you are lazy and not willing to assist your associates when they are in need of your help, their work could ultimately fall to you should they become indisposed. We all know that, especially in this time of cuts. Here's a wonderful example of Francis Barlow's 17th century etching, perhaps the father of English-born illustrators. The fox urges the tiger to fight the man who had shot an arrow at him. The tiger replies that if the man was capable of sending such a stinging small messenger as an arrow, the man himself must be even more formidable. Here is Jan Punt's interpretation of an Udry composition. It is a fable of the crow who imitated an eagle by trying to lift up a sheep from the ground to take as a meal. The crow's claws got stuck in the fleece and he was caught by a shepherd boy who delighted in chiding him. The fables seem to suggest that those who try to match the powerful often overreach themselves and get teased for their efforts. Most of the scenes for my book were drawn from direct observation and set in Ditchling, the village in Sussex where I've lived for 40 years. We looked at a number of images now that have locations in Ditchling as background settings. The book jacket shows our village church, while the other two illustrations are farm buildings very close to where we live. The building in the top right image eventually collapsed in a heap. And when the new farmer came to restore it many years later, he used my drawing for architectural reference. This is an old house called Wings Place in Ditchling, currently owned by the broadcaster Jamie Theaston. I did the preliminary drawings for this sitting on a bench within the church grounds. The white space, by the way, is where the text is in the book. Wherever possible, I like my illustrations to be printed the same size as the original drawings. People often ask me how long it takes to produce them. This one took 37 hours and 38 minutes to draw, almost what used to be a conventional week's work, but now it's 70 hours a week, isn't it? Used to be 40. Here is a view of the village green with a church and Wings Place, that house we were talking about, in the distance. Only the left-hand tree near the church survived the 1987 storm. This one took 10 and a half hours to draw, by the way. Here is a view of the village green with a church and Wings Place. I said that. About to repeat myself. This is a view of part of the village churchyard in green. It shows the ant and the fly on a tombstone, furiously debating which of the two was the more prestigious. This one took 11 hours and 24 minutes to draw. The wolf and the lamb on the left are situated in the lane that leads to our house. The tree just behind the lamb also fell victim to the 1987 storm. On the right, we have a wise old owl perching on my studio roof and the view looking at the rest of the roof of our house. This is really what I'm showing now, just to recap what I said earlier, to show you the inspiration, the settings of the fables. The house in between those two pine trees is where I live. The tree on the right is the one that fell on my studio, at least a branch of it, whilst I was working on the book. This is a good fable about peace, on the right, with a timid hare saying to the lion, "This is the day for which I've longed, when the weak are feared even by the strong." The bat is hovering at night time, showing a glimpse of the roof of an old cart barn. The church spire and Ditchling Church in the distance. There are a number of fables about war. Subjects range from inciting strife and preparing arms to the plight of civilians when the powerful wage war, such as how a change of government can often make little difference to the ordinary citizen. This one points a finger at those who waver and stand on both sides of the fence in an argument, warning them that they are liable to be mistrusted by both sides. Hence, the bat is consigned to fly at night because neither bird nor animal will tolerate a creature who at one moment pretends to be a bird and at another an animal, whoever happens to be winning the battle at any one time. Ockley Manor is shown in the picture below it, a grand house in the neighbouring village of Keema. Since the fable on the right is about a quack frog, you can see him sort of there, sitting on a soapbox. Since it's about a quack frog, I've drawn what was then our village doctor surgery for this illustration. This on the left is a dog placed in one of our village lanes. It is a fable of an old hound who is beaten because his master becomes impatient with him because he can no longer fulfill the tasks expected of him. The hound pleads in vain, urging his master to remember how good he was in the past when he was young and strong. a moving and plaintive tale which strikes a chord for anybody getting old like me. I drew the dog on its own here, to emphasise the loneliness of the rejected beast, and to hint that we could be the master looking at him, pointing, if you like, to sensitise the viewer of the picture as a possible perpetrator of such cruelty. The other is the shortest fable I know. A fox criticises a lioness for only bearing one cub at a time. True, says the lioness, but it's a lion. Here I have tried to show the smugness of the cub, the haughtiness of the lion, and the impudent questioning of the fox. The fable of the donkey eating prickly thistles is essentially about one person's meat is another man's poison. This is a setting in a field next to our house in Ditchley. I sometimes include bits and pieces about our own house too in my illustrations. The chest, the candlestick, the cheese container, the soup tureen, the book and the honey pot are all items in our home. This fly was drawn with the aid of a magnifying glass from one I swatted. It took an hour and nine minutes to draw, not including catching it. It took probably longer. Thoughts about illustrating fables. I want now to talk about some of my thoughts about illustrating in general and fables in particular. Narrative illustrations could be said to provide an unnecessary distraction to the reader in that their very presence may freeze out the imaginative mind of the reading viewer. Our reading of texts and our viewing of illustrations can be each modified and in some cases stultified by our experience of the other, and we may be affected by which we look at first, the text or the illustration. We're often drawn to pictures before we have read the text. Readers might be irritated by having their own visual imagining stripped away from them, and are therefore illustrators have to be on their mettle if they're going to contribute that something special in order to sustain a special interest and enlightenment beyond what the text has to say. Images aid memory, and as the reader becomes familiar with the illustration connected with its text, it can take the form of an emblematic symbol of the fable's suggested meaning. Illustrations therefore help the reader retain the fable stories in the memory, each one becoming a kind of pictorial index of the fable. The capacity that images have to ingrain themselves on the memory is one of their vital roles. Here's a double page spread of a facsimile of Caxton's Aesop. Editions of this book were read to bits since there is only one perfect copy left, and that's owned by the Queen. The fairly crude woodcuts were copied from an earlier French edition, which in turn were copied from an earlier Aesop. On the right-hand page, we can see the... on the right-hand page, we can see that footprints not only represent the imprinted memory of a journey once taken, but in these images, they are also a warning to the wily fox that they are going in the same direction towards the sick lion's den, but none of them can be seen coming back out of it. It is fascinating to see here how in Caxton's woodcut on the top right, the woman's dress covers her thigh more than it does in Julian Macho's earlier version on the left, a kind of 15th century censorship. In fact, Caxton isn't attending to his own fable, his own text properly, because in his own text it says that the woman, this is the original, you can see she's naked there, not there, but it says, Aesop says, this woman had eyes in her buttocks, curious thing to have. And therefore, Caxton wasn't, the illustrator wasn't responding to the proper text. Below we can see Bernard Salomon's version carried out 100 years later. It is also interesting again to see how illustrators copied each other's work. In Salomon's illustration, we see that Aesop has replaced the dog. You will recall Christ's Sermon on the Mount when, according to Matthew's Gospel, he said, "Beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but are inwardly they are ravening wolves," an allusion to the well-known fable. Here the ass disguises himself to look stronger and the wolf to look weaker. What interests me about fable illustrations is that they can end in What interests me about fable illustrations is that they can initially conspire to hide the fable's inner meaning by confirming the outer shell of the fable story. At first glance, an illustration tends to support the fable's outer clothing rather than its inner truth. Pictorial representations of fables can appear at first to be straightforward scenes of animals and landscapes, and the story can also possess that matter-of-fact quality. Text and illustration conspire together and become inextricably linked. At first, the image may seem to reinforce the sham of the fable text, being hardly capable of evoking the abstract or metaphorical meaning suggested by the moral. Closer reading of the text and repeated viewing of the images causes to discover the inner metaphorical meaning by association. And ultimately, the image serves as a memory index of the morals represented. To make it graphic is to make it memorable, clearer in the mind, as it were. Fable illustrations are not necessarily what they seem to be on face value. Paradoxically, perhaps, they both disguise and illuminate. The dog refusing to budge from the manger thus becomes a visual embodiment of meanness. He is no longer really a dog, but a symbol representing stinginess. The representative nature of illustration, when it sits next to the word of the fable, joins in with pictorial finesse and sets into concrete the verbal conspiracy of the fiction. We can see the fiction, but we absorb the truth. The dog is what we see, but it is our awareness of meanness that we can feel. Erasmus and John Locke both stress the importance of having illustrations next to fable texts, believing that they help people not only memorize them, but to entertain and inform them. They also reckon that images encourage children to read. Locke, writing about 300 years ago, also believed that drawing was an important part of young people's education, stressing how ideas are, and I quote, "more easily retained and communicated by a little skill in drawing." On the right, we can see a memorable 15th century Italian illustration showing an old lion reduced to feeble old age. The animals take it in turns to wreak their revenge on one who'd been a tyrannical power over them. The lion was niggled and humiliated mostly when he was battered by the hoofs of an ass, not to mention the likely resentment also brought by other windy insults. The brevity of the fable only offers the illustrator a narrow choice of possibilities and allows a limited choice of action. The animals are specified, but their surrounding settings is not usually described in the text. Most fables have a two-part plot, the meeting of the protagonists and then the outcome. Now I want to say something about the transmission of motives to be found in early illustrations. This is a fable about an old man who is so weary of carrying his load of sticks that he wishes he was dead. But when death suddenly appears on the scene, he changes his mind promptly. Life indeed is a better alternative. It is an etching by Marcus Giraerts, the elder of Bruges, perhaps the first to illustrate the fable in a natural way. Top left. to the emblematic simple way, and most of his pieces are, oh, that's marvellous.
I'm sorry, it's just water.
Well played. No, water's not whiskey. Lovely, thank you very much. It's an etching by Marcus Giretz, the Elder of Bruges. Perhaps the first to illustrate fables in a natural way, that's the top left one there, as opposed to the emblematic simple way of most of his predecessors. We'll now look at a number of examples of how some illustrators seem to have followed pictorial motifs supplied by their predecessors with extraordinary reverence or laziness, perhaps. Today we call it plagiarism. Here we have examples of how 18th and 19th English illustrators have copied a late 17th century example. Mind you, the 17th century example is close to 16th century illustrations. The top left is Sebastian Clark's French Aesop of the 1680s, with Elisha Kirtle's replica of it below, shown in reverse here normally, but I've switched it round to show you how they've crimped from. The Kirkle image was copied by for Samuel Croxall's popular English edition of 1722, a book that Buick was very fond of. These two central images are more or less the same. The top one in Draper's popular edition of 1760, and below it is the same in Dodsley's collection of 1802. The two images on the right are two versions by Buick, following to some extent the approach set by the illustrators of the previous images. But he takes it into a more distinctive countryside with a greater embellishment and texture in the wood engraving. Buick is breaking the mould a little. His deft and virtuoso treatment as a wood engraver and his technical innovation is the key to the special qualities in his work, as is his deep knowledge of the countryside and observation of nature. In this Dory version of the same fable, we see no dependence at all on previous illustrations. His approach perhaps increases the dramatic effect with the misty, menacing presence of the ever-hovering Grim Reaper in the distance. I think you can see it there. No. Oh dear, has that wrecked the whole thing? Sorry about that. The selection of a particular passage of text and choosing the precise moment when the action of an event takes place is another fundamental decision a narrative illustrator has to make when planning a picture. It involves depicting a telling selection of gesture and expressions to signify appropriate characterization. The notion of pictures trapping vision and memory into a state of suspended animation and so becoming a record of an event is, of course, significant. This has become fundamental to artists and illustrators who see this static quality of pictures to be the very essence of expression rather than an imposed limitation. The wonder of images is that they are both static and silent and usually flat, printed images that is. They are a way of immortalizing a notion of the present. A representational image transfixes that elusive and quickly vanishing presence, capturing that short instance in time between what has just passed and what is about to happen. Let us look at a number of approaches to fixing what we call the frozen moment. We can just reflect on that. This is the fable about a stag who comes to drink some water and proudly looks at the reflection of his fine antlers in the water. He is ashamed of the sight of his legs and hoofs, however. Suddenly, the hunters and the dogs are upon him, and at first his nimble legs help him to get away from the pack until he comes into the woods where his antlers get entangled in the branches and briars and eventually gets caught. A case of underrating what is truly valuable and betrayed by the source of his own pride, his antlers. A 16th century illustration by Virgil Solis on the left and Gustave Doré's 19th century illustration on the right. In the left image, you'll notice that the illustrator has chosen two main episodes in the one picture, the stag gazing at his reflection in the foreground to the right, and the hunters chasing him later in the background. The larger right-hand picture is Gustave Doré's atmospheric piece, showing the stag mesmerised by the reflection of his handsome antlers. And here is the denouement of the same fable, Samuel Harrod's swirling movement, marvellously portrayed in his dramatic image of the stag getting caught among the branches and pursued by the hounds, with halting movements suggested by the grass as he struggles. Which approach reminds us of the stag's vanity? The gazing at his reflection, as in the Doré earlier, or the catastrophe, as shown here by Harrod? Here's the fable of the fox and the crow, as seen in three stages embroidered on the borders of the Bayeux tapestry. In picture one, top left, seen the higher, well, we can see this here. Between the yellow things, you can see here the fox wanting to prize the cheese out of the crow there. And here, in another stage, the crow is singing. You know, the what happens here, probably you all know about this fable, but crow steals cheese, fox sees the crow up in the tree and says, "You have beautiful plumage, what a beautiful shining black plumage you've got. I wonder if you sing as well as you look." And of course the crow is so flattered by this that she indeed crows, or he crows, and the fox gets the cheese. And here we see the fox in a later one with the cheese. This one is a different fable, but I thought I'd show you a bit of the section, these borders of the Bayeux tapestry, to give you a feeling of the colour and the embroidery. Fables can be double-edged instruments of instruction, teaching us right and wrong at the same time, but not necessarily right from wrong. Readers can judge themselves what can be learned from them. The moral here warns us not to be seduced by the flattery of others. We also may learn that there are great advantages to be gained from flattering people. Jean-Jacques Rousseau had doubts about the value of fables for children, reckoning that most young people would read them in the opposite way to the author's intention. But who says what the author's intention was? He reckoned that a child would too easily identify with the fox, the flatterer. This is my version showing the action in our back garden at home. Having made a study of well over 100 illustrations of this fable, the single instance of time mostly favoured by illustrators is at the early stage of the plot, when the fox starts to flatter the crow. Is this the most telling moment, or is it the climactic moment when the crow sings and releases the cheese? Or is it best portrayed at the end of the fable, when the fox finally manages to get hold of the cheese? Here are the hare and the tortoise on the left, in which the two creatures agree to have a race to see who's the fastest. The tortoise wins the race, showing that a less gifted but industrious plodder can overtake a smug and lazy hare who is supposed to possess all the natural talent. Some illustrators show the action of the fable at the point when the two agree to have a race, whereas some, including myself, show the thrilling finish at the final take. And on the right, my illustration of the fox and the grapes. The fox is hungry, he notices the grapes on top of a vine. He keeps jumping up, hoping to catch a cluster of them, and he can't get them, so he goes off in a huff saying the grapes were sour anyway. At what point do we choose to portray the action here? I decided to have the fox at the beginning of the action, or perhaps nearly at the end of it, in the ambiguous position of either lusting after the out-of-reach grapes at the beginning, or shouting sour grapes at the end. Which arrested moment do we feel is most appropriate, most memorable in depicting these fables? Here we would hardly tell at first glance that these illustrations are for the same fable, about a man whose cart gets stuck in the mud and without lifting a finger himself. The carter reckons if he prays to the god Hercules, he will be helped to budge it. Put your shoulders to the wheel yourself, came the reply, a fable that urges self-sufficiency. In one, we can see the action from a great distance, and the other two, we are very close to the carter praying to Hercules. How are we going for time? All right.
Fine.
All right. Oh, I'll mention just something about why I've shown that. Again, this is unity of strength divided before. A lion is looking at those bulls, and he's wanting to separate them so he can catch one, but they stick together. And here's the illustrator myself actually thinking, well, let us be the lion, let the viewer be the lion, not necessarily an onlooker. So there are things you can do to create that. Here's another examination of the viewpoint. The fable about the wolf and the shepherds is a sharp lesson in hypocrisy, the way people practice themselves the very thing they are apt to condemn in others. Plutarch tells a tale about a wolf observing shepherds eating a lamb in their shelter and saying, what a fuss they'd make if they saw him doing the same thing. Harrison Weir's 1868 illustration on the left places the viewer's vantage point with the wolf, watching him peer through the door of the shepherd's hut, thinking to himself what a clamour they would raise if he was found eating a lamb. Two versions of Tenniel illustration on the left. Spot the subtle differences between them. In these illustrations, we are placed among the shepherds inside a hut. We, the all-knowing viewer with our omniscient presence, can see the wolf looking through the door behind the other shepherd's backs. We know what they cannot see. In both images, the shepherds are heedless of the wolf's presence. In the text too, it seems as if the wolf has quickly passed by the hut and murmured to himself about their hypocrisy. We are party to the wolf's musing in the text and his presence in the pictures. The illustrator's decision to distance the viewer from the shepherds allows us to be at one with the wolf and his opinions. These are instances when illustrations are able to reinforce the text powerfully by giving us knowing physical presence and an earshot access to the private thoughts of the wolf. In Dory's illustration on the left, we're in the field with the wolf, peering through the hedgerow at the feasting picnickers. It's the same thing. Dory captures that intimate feeling of the wolf musing upon the scene, situated secretly. We know he's there, but the peasants don't. La Fontaine's text has the wolf initially lamenting his carnivorous habits and wanting to reform. He was just planning upon becoming a vegetarian when suddenly he chances upon these three peasants tucking into a leg of lamb. Granville's anthropomorphic piece on the right shows the wolf's anger at a group of hypocrites with revenge written all over his face while he grips his dagger with a reviving lust for meat again. In a book with many pictures, illustrators often need to vary how they project the viewpoint. It gives the advantage of contrast from one illustration to another. Changing eye levels is a good way of doing this, and as we have just seen with the Carter and Hercules, how close or far we may be from the main characters in the picture. Here we are at the bottom of the well, with a fox looking up at the wolf, who is peering down at us from above. If we see things from the fox's point of view, visual in the picture, does this mean we also tend to accept his point of view when it comes to his relationship with the wolf way up above? In the illustration on the right, we as viewers are looking downwards rather than up. Perhaps we are something like another bird perched on the twig of a tree, looking at the cock on the same level and looking down at the fox. In other words, does this perspectival arrangement mean that we are on the fox's side in the left picture and they will support the cock in the right-hand picture? These are things we can consider in pictures, and this is something illustrators might want to manipulate. Just realise I've left my mobile phone on, and how disgusting. Come on, I'll do that and unlock business, don't you? Sorry about that. How disgusting. It's usually the audience that has mobile phones going on all the time. I hope it's gone off now. Here we focus closely to the action of a little mouse assisting a lion to free himself from the net that entangles him. This is a fable which demonstrates that the mighty and powerful in certain circumstances may come to depend on the less strong for help. The fable of the vain jackdaw shows how we should not judge things or people by their appearance, which is prevalent in the day we live in at the moment. And in this case of the vain jackdaw, how fine feathers do not make a fine bird. The view behind the jackdaw is a stretch of the South Downs near to where I live. I'm now going to show you a group of illustrations in which the settings are fabricated from my imagination, not this particular one here. I don't know why I've got that. I should be moving on a bit. From my imagination. We'll go through these fairly quickly. Here's the beetle getting his revenge on the eagle on the left. And on the right, we see three unlikely business partners sailing in the storm. Remember, I'm talking about imaginative settings rather than drawing from direct observation in the village. The wild boar on the right here takes a typical attitude of most countries in matter of defending themselves by building up armaments. In the boar's case, by wetting his tusks as a precaution against possible battles in the future. Here I've tried to give a dynamic to the picture by emphasising diagonal lines by means of having leaning trees, lines that go diagonally on the tree trunk, and the angle of the noses of the two creatures in order to give some kind of energy to the animal's discussion. If I wet my tusks well before danger arrives, says the boar, when it does I'll be ready for war. You might be intrigued by that one there on the left is the dean of my faculty I worked with. But I took his beard off so he wouldn't recognise it. And the expression, what's the expression, I always forget, adding insult to injury comes from this fable because he tries to slap the fly off his bald head. Hurts his head more and the fly, of course, flies away. And that's where the expression adding insult to injury comes from, and you know the goose, the golden eggs, and so forth. Here we have a few illustrations that have no backgrounds at all, just blank spaces. Again, offering contrast to more complex textures of other illustrations in the book. The regal lion here represents the fable about the lion's share, in which a lion tells an ass that despite their hunting successfully as a joint venture, the spoils will all go to the lion. Here's some more. The cat and the dog are family pets that used to have. Another set of illustrations without background. An eagle is killed with an arrow that was made from her own feathers, thus providing the instrument of her own destruction, similarly to being hoisted by one's own petard. The three heads illustrate the fables of the three wishes. A gnome captured by a peasant offers him three wishes to be freed. When he tells his wife back home about this, she insists that the wishes should be made by her. The peasant partly agrees to this so long as he can have the third wish. When she sees her husband gnawing upon a bone, she wishes he had a beak to help him chew it. Seeing the horror of this, she wishes that it could be removed, but no nose took its place. So the third and final wish, the man naturally chose to have his nose restored. finally, with these no backgrounds, as it were, with a lot of white surrounding, little vignettes, if you like. I love trying to get this intimacy among the animals, getting them engaged with each other, rather like getting actors to do the same things on a stage. Just a few words about drawing in black and white. Making a drawing so that it can be read reasonably easily is always a challenge. Highlights and shadows to create different atmospheres is something worth exploiting. The smiling faces of a smug little fish, purposely wearing white, is contrasted here with the sloping mouths of the greyer and grumpier fish. On the right, the white of the cat's eyes purposefully stand out in order to create that menacing glare, as well as the white of his muzzle and bottom jawline, to further highlight his vicious expression. I wanted the cock's head and claw to be dark to stand out against the white flagstones. The white of the cock's eye is drawn to emphasize the doomsday effect as he comes to realize his imminent demise. Drawing in black ink, but thinking of the white areas all the while, is a constant fascination. In the back of your mind, you have to anticipate where you want white passages to be whilst drawing in black. You have to think of black and white equally, rather like being conscious of playing the piano, the pauses in between the notes, as well as the notes themselves. As I mentioned earlier, legend suggests that Aesop met his death around 560 BC at the hands of the priests of Delphi, who are said to have hurled him over a precipice from Mount Parnassus for infuriating them. They set him on a trumped-up charge for stealing the golden chalice from the Temple of Apollo. Here is the actual scene in Delphi, where this event is alleged to have taken place. The last fable in my book is the one entitled The Belly and the Members, or The Stomach and the Limbs. In the fable, we have a stomach and other parts of the body disputing about their respective strengths and qualities, and not appreciating that each has an important function of its own to maintain the other for its common good of the body as a whole. The same way that all countries should be waking up to what needs to be done for the common good of the earth and all the people who live in it. So, to end with, here we have a self-portrait of the naked illustrator John Vernon Lord lying down upon his own bed, dead. Thank you.
It's funny, but I remember when I did an Edward Lear book, and I remember my wife, and I don't know if she remembered this, but I can remember a time when we looked at it together, 330 pictures in it, and she said, which ones would you do again? I said, all of them except for five. So in a way you get sort of rather tired of your own illustrations. You're always looking forward to doing the next thing, you know what I mean?
Yes, I do.
I quite like that one of the Wings Place, the one with the big building and the wolf and the monkey and the fox.
Mm-hmm.
I quite like the background of the one with the four bulls in it.
Mm-hmm.
But you always want to correct them, this is the trouble. You just have to stop illustrating it. You can't go on forever making it better and better, if you know what I mean. You have to decide at some point, well, that's it. And there we are.
Can I just ask you, it was interesting in the one of the four bulls, the lion was outside.
Yeah,
it was
the picture, yeah.
Is that not what you were doing in your Amherst book, showing it from passage?
Very nearly that. I mean, I've done the two Alice books by Lewis Carroll, and I've chosen not to include Alice in it at all, which, because it's a limited edition book, nobody will be furious. But I think a lot of people will be absolutely angry with me for doing it. And I compensated for her lack of presence by having her text emboldened in blue text so that you can follow her very clearly. That was an idea coming from, there's a Bible called the Red Letter Bible, I don't know whether you know it, which is when Christ speaks, you see his words highlighted in red, but I chose blue for this particular book. And partly it's a notion of her experience of who she met on these two dreams that she had, one in Wonderland and one in Looking Glass. And it was because Alice has been illustrated by at least 300 British illustrators, it seemed to me you've got to have a new angle on the whole subject to give people a new experience of what is, in my view, a wonderful book.
Slightly off the point, I love the fables, but I love the backgrounds. Have you ever done any work just of the countryside and ditch around it?
Now and again, it's interesting you said that, because it's only recently I've been doing a lot of, well, not a lot, but drawing occasional landscapes in notebooks and things like that. I think if I had a dream, I would have been a landscape painter like Girtin, or not so much Turner, but more like Girtin, I think. I think to be a landscape painter would be marvellous. Hello? Yeah? As an illustrator?
Yeah, how did you start?
Well, I obviously wanted the art education, and I was very lucky to have three particular tutors at Central, four in a way. Mervyn Peake was the sharpest mind of all, although he was terribly ill at the time. I mean, he almost was incompetent in other ways. But he was a very, very sharp mind. Made you think. He was really trying like mad to make you see your own originality. Do you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
I mean, all students should be shown that,
yeah.
Should be helped to go that direction.
Yeah.
And he was brilliant at that. That's Mervyn Peake. Then there was a chap called John Birmingham, some of you may know his children's books. He said, "Look, John, stop being a student. Why don't you go out and get some work?" So I left a postgraduate course because I was flattered by John Birmingham's view, and the other teacher was Stanley Badman, a marvellous Sussex landscape painter. I don't know if you know his work. And he said, "I've got just the agent for you, my agent. Why don't you see them?" So all this happened for the last two bits, the Badman and the Birmingham, about 2 days apart, and I suddenly packed up being an art student, didn't finish my course, and had an agent called Saxon Artists who gave me work from advertising agencies. I mean, I drew everything. I drew typewriters, I drew folded towels, I drew globes, I drew really quite a lot of lavatories. I drew a whole set of lavatories. And, you know, this was unexpected, because when you're an art student, you have these huge ideas about, doing some splendid creative things. And here I was doing, I was a jobbing illustrator for years. I mean, certainly from, say, about 61 to 1968. And then I got my first children's book in 1968. And things went well from there on. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, no, it does. I just think in schools that there's not
think that we should have the fine art GCSE, but I think it's not progressive enough. I think there should be more art.
Well, I agree. You heard that bit about John Locke saying that everybody should be able to draw. Well, I think looking and listening, not hearing and seeing, but looking and listening, should be the, what they call them, main curriculum in schools.
Yeah.
I mean, looking and listening, we all require it. I mean, solicitors need it, policemen need it, artists need it. Looking, these are the faculties we should be thinking about, I think, at primary school right up to, well, the rest of your life. And I don't think people are taught to look and listen as they should. You may disagree.
No, I agree totally.
Mm.
Yeah. Sorry, I'm in a bit late. But is your work mostly with ink or is it etching?
It's ink. It's pen and ink.
And is it, have you done your own fables with it?
Do you mean my own?
Yeah,
like
have you been tempted to write your own?
I've done my own children's books,
yeah.
about 4 or 5.
Okay.
I mean, the most successful one was at one called The Giant Jam Sandwich, which was very successful. In fact, the probably only successful book I've done, but that's still in print after 40 years. And that was a story I wrote. I've written about 5 stories, 5 picture book type things for children.
Did you find Roald Dahl at all inspirational?
Well, I nearly illustrated, I knew Roald Dahl quite well because we worked in the same publishing house.
Yeah.
And I very nearly did his Danny is the Champion of the World.
Oh,
wow. And I was quite thrilled to do it because I loved his work. I knew his adult work mostly because Danny Champion of the World, I think, was one of his first inroads into children's books. Great story if you know it.
Mm-hmm.
It's well worth reading. And being a university lecturer prohibited the time factor that the publishers wanted it to be completed. I guess anybody who teaches know how that infringes on doing your other work. You know. Hello. Sorry, I couldn't see you.
I was just wondering, like, how do you balance, like, illustrating and working? Like, how do you find the time to, like, do it well? Do it well? Do you know what I mean? Like,
you mean using time? Well, when I was a full-time university person, which you will know, I'm sure the others told you, it's a really full-time job. I Saturdays and Sundays, at least the university, although you had lots of boring sometimes 500 pages of documents to read, I was allowed, permitted to go in the studio, probably more than I deserved, by a certain wife that I had. And she was very supportive that I could have the time to do it in the weekends. That was crucial. I used to get up very early, much earlier in those days, 6:30. And I could get 2 hours before I went to the university in the mornings on weekdays. Often worked in the evenings in those days. Now I'm retired from teaching. It's a much better situation, really. Although I used to have a rule in the vacation that my pencil had to be touching the paper at 9 o'clock in the morning. But I had to get up at 7:30 to do that because I'm a great procrastinator. Going to the studio around about 7:30, think, oh, the sunshine, I'll just look at the flowers in the garden. And then you'd done that, then you thought, oh, I just fancy a cup of coffee. And all those delaying mechanisms. But it's a sort of psychological thing. As long as you got up early, you could start working. I think starting a job is, once you've started, you're okay. It's just making that initial thing, isn't it? We all know what that's like. Yeah.
Do you think there's still a big market for illustrators and handmade pages, considering that a lot of the technology nowadays means you can draw using computers and without having to use pens, pencils,
Well, you still, I think, I mean, if you're a drawing illustrator, by drawing I mean making your own marks to make the pictures, if you do it on a computer, it's exactly the same thing. It's still a drawn image done with a mouse or what do they call those pens? Nobody knows what they are.
Graphic pads.
Tablet.
Graphic tablets.
I mean, you're still drawing, so the skills of drawing still apply. But I mean, we know that a lot of computer images can be based on photographs, and layering photograph on photograph, bits of drawing, bits of stolen pieces from other imagery. I mean, the world's your oyster, I think, today, in terms of computer-generated artwork. I think one of the problems, fashion is always a problem, I think, in that everybody starts doing the same images. So you almost get tired. I mean, if you look, I mean, this is slightly changing the subject, but if you look at the Radio Times, do any of you know the Radio Times? You count the amount of photographic portraits of people. It's just people, isn't it? Usually celebrities. That we're stuck now with, we want to know what celebrities look like. And, you know, of course they're all very beautiful. And I think that's a fashion at the moment. At one time, Radio Times was a fabulous publication for illustrators. And they had big pages of illustrations. And there was a lot of contrast because they had the photographs too. And you'd have a wonderful magazine which displayed artwork by sometimes as many as 20 illustrators and photographs. And now it's just portrait after portrait after portrait of people we know what they look like anyway. But what was your question? I've got off the point. Oh, computer. Did I answer that properly? I mean, in a way.
You spoke briefly about the two types of illustration that you do, the kind from life and from your imagination.
Yeah.
Could you speak more about that, how you find the differences?
Yes. I think when you're an early art student, and always when you're an older artist, shall we say, or illustrator, I think drawing from life is always surprising.
Mm.
You always think, oh heavens, I forgot things look like that, or the way the light falls on something. The way the distance looks different. You know, that whole business of looking and observing stimulates the mind. And if you draw from imagination, what you're losing is what I've just said, but it's creating something else. It's creating something which is, if you like, impoverished of reality, but it can be awkward and interesting because of that. Does that make sense?
Well, especially I suppose with fantasy as well, you know,
yeah.
Seems essential
in
that, but the more practice that you are on life drawing, the more things that you've learned about how life falls. And,
No, I think again, it's exploring your own uniqueness, trying to, by A, responding to the world in front of you visually, and sometimes saying, well, no, I'm just going to use my head here and rely on memory and the impoverishment of reality so that you can produce something afresh.
One of your drawings, I think it was the fish in the net, reminded me of an Escher, and I thought that because it was so detailed, maybe it's sometimes playing with perspective. Do you
yeah,
have
well,
one?
I've done that in the Carroll book, of course.
Mm-hmm.
See, that's an example of drawing from the head, those fishes in the net.
Mm.
If you saw the real thing,
mm-hmm.
you would, and you did it well, it would be still interesting,
mm-hmm.
although you'd be lucky to get the fish stop flapping and all that
mm-hmm.
stuff. But reality sometimes you don't always want. You want something slightly artificial.
Well, good point. One more question?
Are we allowed to ask you what you're working on now?
Well, Finnegan's Wake.
Okay. How interesting.
But I've not got a commission for it.
Okay.
But it's a way of understanding it. I mean, if you're an illustrator, some of you possibly are in the room, to understand something, it's marvellous being an illustrator because you have to try and understand what the text is all about.
Mm-hmm.
It's terribly difficult. I mean, I love it for its music, its sound, and I've got a very good Naxos recording of it. It's called Jim Norton reads it beautifully in a Dublin accent. And it's just like a tune, you know, it's just beautifully read. And but Delve, I've got about 12 or 15 books trying to make me understand it by different writers. There are concordances, there are people that have tried like mad to understand it. And I'm loving doing it, actually. I've only done 2.5 illustrations, so don't feel it's... I'm only going to do one for each chapter. But I feel committed to do it. And that's as far as I can answer the question, really.
Thank you so much, John, for a generous and interesting and just a great session. Thank you very much indeed.
Oh, thank you. If you want to look at Aesop, some of you, there are one or two up here.
I mean, the other one, the whole side, and I was
No commercial artist, that's what